Coming up, we discuss new details about the incredible celebration coming to Pixar Place at Hollywood Studios. Google has an It's a Small World-like ride at the CES Tech Conference. We share the New Year's Eve experience one listener had at the Magic Kingdom. And in the main segment, we bring you Star Wars Galaxy's Edge Episode 1, What We Know So Far. All that and more on this episode of WDW Opinion. Cue the music.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome.
This is the podcast where two friends, Connor.
You are a child's plaything.
And Hank.
You are a sad, strange little man. And you have my pity.
Share their opinions, tips, and stories about anything and everything at Walt Disney World.
Trust me. What are you going on?
Get ready, because this is WDW Opinion.
We're in the tower. We are ready for takeoff.
Hello and welcome to episode number 25 of WDW Opinion, the podcast where friends talk Disney. We share our Disney World opinions so that you can start planning for and daydreaming about your next perfect Disney vacation. We share our opinions with our blog, podcast, Facebook live streams, and more. Join the Disney Opinion conversation by following us on social media where we are at WDW Opinion and visit WDWOpinion.com. to check out our blog posts on all things Disney and to see what we're up to in between episodes. There you can also get a free Disney trip planning checklist when you sign up for our weekly email newsletter. I'm your host, Connor Brown, and I'm joined by my co-host and Disney partner in crime, Mr. Hank Molsky. Hank, I'm riding a pretty big high right now. Pretty big high.
You're an international celebrity.
Well, yeah. I mean, you could say that. We got a couple people from England popping in, you know. For those listeners that don't know, yesterday I did my first ever Facebook live stream on our Facebook page, on the WDW Opinion Facebook page. It was a ton of fun. I talked about some news stories. I shared some recent WDW Opinion content. We had a bunch of people come in. Hank was there in the comments section. We had some other listeners to the show, some other fans and friends of the show. Everyone's a friend if you're listening right now, but we've had some previous guests on the show pop in the comments section. It was a ton of fun, and I was really, really happy to do it.
Hey, and the set looked awesome. I loved the setup with the attraction posters, and looks like you had a few other knickknacks back there too.
Yeah, the total set cost me $27,000.
Oh wow! Okay, yeah,
yeah. Which did you get that email I sent you about wiring those funds for that Nigerian prince? It did not.
Yeah,
go.
I got it.
Yeah. Okay, good.
I think you should be getting that.
Yeah, cool.
2 to 3 business days.
Oh, 2 to 3. Okay. Yeah. So my set is basically my living room, but I have some cool attractions.
$27,000. What, you got a smart bathtub back there that they unveiled at CES this week?
It's smart, but it chastises me for being stupid. Yeah, I got some cool attraction posters as the backdrop. I have like a Walt Disney World pennant, like, you know, like a sports pennant, but it says 1971 for the year it opened. Then I also have some postcards hanging up on my wall that are from the Disney College Program Alumni Association. So I'm looking to add some more tchotchkes into the set, you know, the quote-unquote set, some more Disney artifacts, if you will. So, you know, you got to tune in every week, because this is something I'm going to do weekly going forward. Join us on Facebook, facebook.com/WDW Opinion, Tuesdays, 7 p.m. Eastern, you know, going forward, because I'm going to be there sharing news stories. You're going to be able to share your opinions. We're going to comment and interact with each other in real time. Stop by every week, because you never know who or what's going to show up.
Yeah, and you'll also respond to the comments for those of you that tune in late and think you're watching the live stream.
Well, don't.
But you won't react to them in real time.
Yeah, yeah. Don't get your hopes up. No, I'll respond to everyone. It was cool to see, for me to be interacting with people that are listening to the show. You know, I think it's,
yeah, absolutely.
It's this is a passive medium, and we put it out, and we know people are listening. Because of statistics, but you know, we can't put a face to those names or even a name to those listeners. here. This is a great way to build our community, to welcome people in, and to just continue to expand upon that. And that's what I love so much, you know, bringing my smiling face, which my mom has said looks all right on camera.
Oh, direct very quote. Nice.
Yes. My father says, I do have a face for radio. I don't think that's a compliment. But, okay. You know,
going, nice family.
Going forward, join no, us on Tuesdays on Facebook Live. It's going to be a ton of fun. But let's live right now in the present, not next Tuesday, right now, because it's time for our weekly segment, News to Opinion. This is our weekly segment where we each pick a recent Disney news story to discuss our and share our thoughts and opinions on. My Disney news story of the week is that more details are released for an incredible celebration coming to Pixar Place at Disney's Hollywood Studios. So this news article comes right from WDW News Today. And what Disney is doing is they're taking the success of the incredible Tomorrowland Expo that recently ended in Magic Kingdom and bringing it to Pixar Place. Disney really wants to inject some life back into Pixar Place after the Toy Story exodus. And so they're dispatching a team of supers to host a number of neat activities just in time for Hollywood Studios' 30th anniversary. Starting January 18th, Pixar Place will transform into a Municiburg city block right outside of Metroville as part of the limited time incredible celebration. You'll be able to enjoy such activities as the Edna Mode experience. Edna's got a full pop-up gallery complete with some of her most avant-garde suit designs on display. You can browse through her collection of suits and awards and then get to meet the elusive designer herself. Also, there's a scavenger hunt called Where's Jack-Jack? You'll be able to try to find Jack-Jack by following a trail of evidence only a super powerful baby could have left behind. And then you have the Super Shindig. Get ready to dance the baby shark, which, Hank, you don't know what the baby shark is, right?
What?
I think we're too old to understand what the baby shark is.
I don't even want to. A baby shark? That's not in the film.
It's got to be some sort of dance, right? When I heard this the first time, I don't know. Anyways, you'll be dancing the baby shark alongside Frozone, Mr. Incredible, and Elastigirl in this Municiburg dance party. And then, as always, there's going to be...
It's like flossing. That's what it is.
Oh, it's like... baby shark. Is it like flossing?
No, I'm just saying, like, it's the equivalent of something... You know, it's like Soulja Boy.
Soulja Boy, tell him. I remember that back in middle school.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
I guess we're
Superman
just,
that.
I know. Superman that. Anyways.
moving on.
Superman that. Whatever. There's going to be an array of specialty-themed foods available during the incredible celebration.
Cookie Num-Nums?
Oh, what? Yes, cookie including num-nums? The Jack-Jack Cookie Num-Nums. So this was a reference to Incredibles 2. Mr. Incredible would give Jack-Jack a cookie num-num, anytime he was acting crazy to calm him down. And Disneyland just announced this cookie num-num, when they opened Pixar Pier back in the summer of 2018, and people were freaking out for it.
Yeah. Really?
It's a gigantic cookie-like thing, basically, that's in almost like a cupcake, like tinfoil wrapper. It looks gigantic, and people really, really like it. So it's excited to make its way to Walt Disney World. I'm excited to see it and try it. Other food items include, of course, the Hero Sandwich and Miss Incredible's Mask with Cheese, which I believe is...
Connor, I got to ask, Is that a hero with an H sandwich or a hero with a G sandwich?
Oh, that's a hero with an H sandwich.
Okay, just wanted to make sure.
Not a gyro for us Americans.
Gyro sandwich.
No, a
hero. Yeah, I had to make sure, since, you know, could be a clever play on words out. No.
It's not a clever play. It's just hero. It's not even a play. It's... Mrs. Incredible's Mask with Cheese, I believe, is just a like a pretzel, like a soft pretzel that gives you dipping cheese, and it's in the shape of her mask. But that's not all. Starting January 18th, you'll be able to meet your favorite scarers in all of Monstropolis, while Sonny and Mike Wazowski will be meeting guests in Walt Disney Presents, which is just right around the corner from this location. So I think this is very cool because, one, instead of it just being a quick retheme, which Disney has done in the past and recently for sure, they're adding more elements. It's not just a dance party where you can dance the baby shark and other generic or other unknown dances that two, you know, mid 20-year-old men don't know about, like flossing or things like that.
We do know about flossing though.
Well, yeah, I get kind of. Yeah, I still can't figure it out. I still can't figure out how to floss.
I can't do it.
Not figured. I won't. But they're having unique experiences like the Edna Mode experience with the full pop-up gallery. Like they're putting some details behind it, some actual planning. Anytime you get new specialty goods, even though they're things we've had before in terms of food, there's an investment being made in that area. So this section really opened up with Toy Story Midway Mania, and it was designed to look like Pixar's Emeryville, California headquarters. And it looks very much like it. Like the brick is the same color and tones as their brick buildings. The big Pixar gate as you enter looks like the gate at Pixar Studios. But where this makes sense for me is the theming of that. Oh, I'm sorry. So they closed that area because when Toy Story Land opened, Midway Mania's entrance moved over there. So there was no need for that section because you would typically walk in, the right would be Midway Mania, the left would be a Buzz and Woody character meet and greet, and then that was it.
I'm sure Disney Twitter has commented this, and I don't know if you and I have ever talked about it, but Connor, did you notice that the scale is just a little bit different inside Midway Mania compared to the scale that you are elsewhere in Toy Story Land?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think...
You're a little bit bigger. Yeah. Not quite the size of the toy that you were before.
But, you know, that was their first go at it. Yep. You know, with Midway Mania.
So came, we
you know,
went smaller for the next one.
Yeah, came some 10 years before Toy Story Land.
Yeah, so that's funny.
So Pixar Place has sat abandoned for a few months now. But this coming in, I think, fits well because the Incredibles have this kind of mid-century modern feel, this kind of... I don't know, kind of look, but that's what the Pixar Place already feels like mid-century modern, stuff like that. So I think this fits well, and it can remind you of, you know, Metropolis or a Munisburg, nice Metroville, fit. I should say.
Yeah, should be a nice fit.
Should be a nice fit. All right, Hank, let's move away from The Incredibles. What's your news story of the week?
It is the Consumer Electronics Show in Las Vegas this week, Connor.
What?
I'm actually going to bring us an outside news story that we from a place that we don't usually go to, the Associated Press. I'll double check. Okay, let's read the about page.
I don't know if that's on the list or not.
The Associated Press wrote this today about yesterday. Apologize, we're recording on the 9th. But CES is this week. It runs from the 7th through the 10th out in Las Vegas. It's kind of the big showcase where a lot of tech companies go out there and show their future, for, you know, the prototypes for the next several years in big tech or big products that they're rolling out in the near future. So Google is one of the biggest advertisers, biggest spenders out there. And this story is about them because it's got a pretty unique Disney tie, and it starts off with the headline of this article. Google brings a Disney-like ride to the tech show. Well, they can't bring a ride. Disney calls them attractions. So,
idiots.
Nice job, AP. The CES gadget show opened its doors Tuesday with tech companies. I guess it did start on Tuesday. That's my bad. So it started the 8th, but I guess people were getting out there on the on the 7th. But the CES Gadget Show opened its doors Tuesday with tech companies from giants to tiny startups showing off their latest products and tech. Yada, yada, yada. Google has transformed CES into a Disney-like theme park complete with singing animatronic macaroons. I can't read that word without messing
every
up.
Every single time.
Yeah.
You struggle with that word.
Macaroons. To showcase, I've lost my train of thought. To showcase new features of its voice-enabled digital assistant. I'm going to skip ahead to the good stuff. This article's all over the place. Google this year has an amusement park ride that resembles Disney's It's a Small World. No, it doesn't. We'll get to that. Through a roller coaster-like train at slow speeds. Talking and singing characters showcase Google's various voice assistant features as visitors ride along. So, Connor, it's like a minute and 43 second long dark ride that Google built just for this thing. And it
so wait a second. Is
on like fire out there.
So all right, so there's a ton of people going, but is it on the showroom floor?
No, it's in Google's like building that they've rented out. So yeah, it's like it counts as being in the showroom.
Gotcha.
Though.
That's crazy.
Yeah, so they built us. But if you look at like there's this one area where you ride in front of a mirror and some people are taking like photos in front of the mirror. It's like it looks like the track at like one of those little roller coasters that runs through like the center of like the Mall of America something. It's not that impressive, but like when from the body up, it's a nice looking train. The animatronics look really good. The set pieces are really finished. I mean, it's nice. I joked on Twitter already. Like it, this thing, day one, already better than Voyage of the Little Mermaid. But
that's cold, brother. That's cold.
Yeah, that's ice cold. Take that. And then it actually rides outside and it goes up the strip for a second. I mean, it's
crazy.
Pretty cool. I definitely encourage you to check it out. We'll put it on some of our social media pages afterwards. Everyone's talking about it. You could probably just do a quick search afterwards as well. Just
a quick Google ride. Oh, you can't Google.
Nope. Yeah, you can. You'll tear a hole in the universe. So Connor, it got me thinking though. It's like, a lot of people looked at this thing, and I think a few places thought this. I definitely did. Google spent some serious cash on this thing.
Oh, yeah.
From the manpower it takes to how expensive it is to put people in Vegas this week to how expensive it is to, you know, rent the space, light it, run it, do a thing that you've never done before for 4 days. And that's to go along with all the R&D, all the man hours they pumped into this thing. It just makes you think – Google spent so much money on this. It's going to be there for 4 days. They're going to box it up, and it's going to be in like the corner office of their headquarters maybe, if at all. It might just get totally torn down for a four-day event. And it's just like, you know, back in the day, no company ever would have done that. They would have said, I'm going to put my name on a Disney ride. Here's the check that I just was going to write instead of building my own. Put me on the front of Spaceship Earth.
I think it's crazy because, you know, back in the day, that's how the attractions were built. It wasn't, you know, and it'd be nice if we got it sponsored. No, it was, we need the money to build these rides. Like, there wasn't going to be a Space Mountain without RCA. Like, that wasn't going to exist, right? Disneyland, Epcot, and Magic Kingdom in Disney World, their big e-ticket attractions, for the most part, had to be privately funded, had to have sponsorships in order for them to exist. I mean, Universe of Energy had Exxon Mobil, you know. Test Track is one of the only remaining ones, but that's had, you know, Chevy and GM before. It wasn't it'd be nice to have, you know, kind of sponsorship. It's a, we need this in order to build these attractions. And it's crazy because what used to be a partnership more than anything of Kodak and Disney coming together, or Disney and Siemens partnering together, Disney and Exxon Mobil partnering together, for decades and decades has become a thing of those brands don't see value in those long-term partnerships. Brands are starting to see more value in those short-term things that generate a lot of buzz and stuff like that. But I also think, you know, the juxtaposition of that to something where we just had college football season here, just ended in the States, and we have all these bowl games, and you have these weird companies like the San Diego Federal Credit Union sponsoring a bowl, or Little Caesars, or Meineke Car Care sponsoring a football game.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money for, you know, 3-hour event that I think people are maybe seeing, or they anticipate more bang for their buck than signing on for, you know, albeit a gigantic contract, lots of millions of dollars to sponsor a Disney ride, at that they're not willing to risk that. And I think that plays into the fact of they're not willing to put up that money and not know if they get a return off of it, just like Disney isn't willing to risk any new outside-of-the-box, non-IP-based rides without the proper funding.
Yeah, you know, and it's interesting now that you say that too, especially in this age of, you know, consolidation, mega competitors. You know, it seems like there's fewer and fewer companies that are all competing, you know, in different areas. I don't think Disney and Google, you know, stepping back, I don't think they play too nicely, because I think Disney is pretty buddy-buddy with Apple.
Oh, yeah.
And Apple and Google could not be bigger competitors.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
Oh, yeah.
So, I mean, if you go through the Disney parks, I mean, you hear more about Apple Pay for sure than you do, you know, Google Pay. That's there's no doubt about that.
And, you know, that goes back to Steve Jobs was, you know, one of the co-founders of Pixar.
Yeah.
So when Disney bought Pixar, you know, there was this whole – and when they partnered with them before on Toy Story and all those films, there was already this partnership with Apple. So that's where that comes. And, you know, Bob Iger has been on the board of Apple. Tim Cook has, I believe, been on the board of – or no, Steve Jobs was on the board of the Disney company. So there's a great partnership with them and Apple. So I don't see this, you know – playing out into Google sponsoring an attraction anytime down the road. But
maybe let's get Apple to do a Spaceship Earth reskin then. How about that?
That would be cool.
Maybe Steve Jobs' head is on that ride.
Who really knows?
Or Steve Wozniak. We don't really know.
All right. Well, there you go. We have some Incredibles coming to Hollywood Studios, and we have Google not coming to Epcot anytime soon. So last week, we shared one of our favorite holiday traditions with you, which is being mesmerized at wait times and crowd levels during the holidays at Walt Disney World. Well, a listener of the show was in Magic Kingdom on New Year's Eve this past year, and he sent us an email describing his experience. So I want to read the email to show you what you can expect if you go to the parks during the holidays. So this is from listener Brett, and he says, I was listening to your podcast titled What We're Looking Forward To in 2019, which was our last episode, episode 24, and I thought I would help with some firsthand feedback. I was in the parks this past New Year's Eve. It was crazy. To preface my experience with Walt Disney World, I have taken vacations to the parks on more than 10 occasions, including 4 in the past 3 years. So Brett is pretty much a seasoned professional when it comes to going to Disney World. He's been many, many times. He knows what to expect. He goes on to say, I have never seen anything like the parks was on New Year's Eve. The alert went out on the app, meaning the My Disney Experience, at 11:35 a.m. that the Magic Kingdom entrance was closed. Then, at about 5 p.m., they made an announcement that no more guests were going to be allowed in front of the castle. That boggles my mind, because it's 5 p.m., there was an early fireworks show at 6:30. Right? But people had to have been...
7 hours. 7 hours.
Had to have been lining up before then to see the 6:30 p.m. fireworks show, right?
Oh, so much so that... It makes me sick to my stomach.
An hour and a half before the fireworks even started, they had to go over the loudspeaker that said, if you're trying to get towards the castle, you can't go any further. That's how many people there are. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Brett goes on to say, one positive is that many guests left after the first fireworks show. So they did have 2 fireworks shows that night. He says, would I do it again? No. Not because of the crowds, but because the access to fast passes and rides were non-existent. To eliminate any confusion about fast passes, because Hank and I brought up the question last week about what if... Because there's so many people there, were the fast pass lines longer? Like, maybe Disney upped the quantity of fast passes so that they could put more people in the queues, but that would mean fast pass line would be more than the typical 15-minute wait that you're supposed to see. Brett says the fast pass lines ran as smoothly as normal as they normally do, with the exception of when a ride went down, those people all went to the other fast pass lines, and some in the standard queue also got fast passes. But even when that happened, we only waited once more than 10 to 15 minutes in a fast pass line. He says, if I was forced to do it again, the one thing we did that I would recommend anyone going at that time do is book a dessert party. We sat on Tomorrowland Terrace with space to move around, a private bathroom reserved for the party, unlimited desserts, and unlimited non-alcoholic drinks, all while enjoying the show without getting there 3+ hours ahead of time to stand shoulder to shoulder. Make sure to log in and book it the moment you can book dining reservations, because I did it and the late one was already sold out, meaning they had 2 dessert parties that night coinciding with the two fireworks shows. So I think these dessert parties, Hank, get a lot of flack, especially with the Disney online community.
Oh, yeah, they do.
They get a lot of flack because the way people see it is it's just another way Disney is trying to gouge you price-wise. They're just trying to milk you for all you're worth, right? You have to buy the ticket to the park, and then you get the privilege to buy a ticket to the dessert party on top of your admission. They're saying, you know, all the Disney fans are like, this is crazy. Like, this is so unfair.
Yeah.
Why do they need this? They don't need to do this. Disney doesn't need to do anything. But here's listener Brett, who saw a problem. He knew the crowds were going to be packed. He knew they were going to be very crowded, and he knew seeing the fireworks was probably going to be a challenge. Well, Disney presented him with a solution. They said, hey, if you pay a little bit more for your party, we're going to give you unlimited desserts, unlimited non-alcoholic drinks, but we're going to give you a way to view the fireworks in a space where you're going to be able to move around. You're not going to feel like, you know, a school of fish packed to the gills. You're going to get your own private bathroom reserved for the party. And the big kicker is you're not going to have to go and stand for 3.5 hours ahead of time to stand shoulder to shoulder just to watch the fireworks. Because I think that's the big thing.
Damn near priceless.
The big thing here is the time you save not having to hold your place in line in a crowd to see the fireworks.
Because, oh, Connor, I forgot about that too. Can you imagine that with kids on Main Street?
Just like
how long you'd have to wait?
Why are we waiting here? We have to see this. All right. Well, why are we waiting here?
Brett, I gotta go to the bathroom.
Yeah. No, not anymore. Not no more. You better hold it for 4 more hours. Brett was able to experience the park, albeit a very, very crowded park, but he was able to experience it for 3 hours instead of having to just stand there, because he knew he had the Tomorrowland Terrace dessert party booked. Listen, this is a solution to a problem. Yes, you're going to have to pay, but there's always a consequence in order to find a solution. If this is something you want to do and you know you're going to have to go at a very busy time, this is a great opportunity to save time and to guarantee a good spot to see these shows. You might have to make some sacrifices. You might have to have a couple more quick service meals rather than sit down meals so you can afford this. But in the long run, and what Brett is saying here is it's easy money. It's very, very beneficial.
Yeah. I'll tell you one thing. I love Brett. Thanks so much for sending that in. Really got both of us thinking. I'll tell you one thing I thought after reading that. I know how you and I said, like, yeah, let's try it once. I never want to do Magic Kingdom. No. really don't. Not on New Year's Eve day.
If it's a quick pop in, like go up to the train station and look down at people and then just run out. But I don't think I could ever do Magic
I mean, at Kingdom. Least Epcot's got that unique angle of, you know, the different times of the New Year's going off, that type of thing.
And Epcot is wider. You know, the walkways are wider and there's more space, I feel, when
more
you're moving
There's
around.
Two exit points there's to two exit get points. Out of the back of the park.
Yeah.
That makes a big difference. So it's like going in a cave. I wouldn't want to go in the cave that's Magic Kingdom and know that the only way out of the cave is the way that I just came in.
Oh, God. Through the train station. Could you imagine?
Yeah. Oh, no, man. No. See, it makes me really uneasy.
Yes.
Thanks for that, Brett.
Thanks.
But actually, I really do like that because now I know not to go there for sure on New Year's Eve day, or at least go too far in.
Yeah.
The other part of Brett's email, I know you wanted to share about the wait times. Enjoy that.
So one thing Hank and I always like to do is on Thanksgiving, Christmas, and New Year's Eve day, we like to go on the My Disney Experience app and see how high the wait times we'll get. We typically go on the app like around noon because that's always the most crowded the parks are. And we are just always flabbergasted about how high these wait times are. So Brett goes, also, I think you missed the longest wait time in the parks that week. On January 4th at 5:54 p.m., Avatar Flight of Passage was a 250-minute wait. I have a screenshot as well to share with you if you want.
So I got excited. I went through my archives because I got a million screenshots. I hate that about the iPhone. It's just they're all in my folder.
Yeah.
I was like, I was at the mall the other day, but I didn't take this picture. She's screenshotting a picture of Animal Kingdom while my wife is shopping. December 27th, or no, December 29th at 11:37 a.m., Brett. Flight of Passage, 295
minutes. 295
minutes.
Hank, weren't you saying that, like, with the pre-show and the show, you'd be able to watch the actual Avatar movie twice in that amount of time?
Yeah, twice through. Oh, yeah.
Freaking insane. But I think what Brent crazy. Points something out here, which I didn't realize. Hank and I stopped looking at the My Disney Experience app, like, around January 2nd. But here's Brett saying, no, on January 4th, Avatar Flight of Passage was at 255 minute wait. I know kids are out of school during that time, but it just didn't like resonate with me that January 4th was going to be that crowded. It's crazy.
Yeah, you and I have got that mindset of just like, yep, January 2nd, everyone goes back to work. But no, a lot of people, and you know, now that I think about it too, there were enough people in your office, probably my office, like a couple of neighbors on my street that were like, yep, we're doing our ski trip January 2nd. A lot of people probably did the, yep, we're doing our Disney trip January 2nd.
January 2nd, yeah. We got a couple of days when nothing's going to be going on. Yeah. That's a good point. But you know, I had a couple follow-up emails with Brett because I was asking him if I could read his email on the podcast, and he said, absolutely. And he said, I actually am passionate about this because I want people to know, because I experienced so many people who were taken aback by the crowd levels. They had no idea that the crowds were going to be like this. They were going in thinking crowds are going to be low because everyone's going to be at their house enjoying the holidays. When they get there, they are shocked at the level of people. And he said, I'd actually appreciate you sharing this story because I think more people will learn from that and understand that these times are no joke, man. They are crowded. You got to go in with a serious game plan if you're going at these points in time, because it's intense.
Yeah. It's not a family experience almost.
It's not. It is not.
Well, we love talking about it, obviously, and we'll continue to do it more and more, and hopefully informing more folks that you're in for quite the rodeo when you get down there.
Absolutely. Brett, thank you again so much for sharing your email with us. I hope people were able to get some insight into what it's like on New Year's there. If you have some stories you want to share from us, or you have a trip report you're fond of, you can send them to me, Connor, C-O-N-O-R, at WDWopinion.com. We might even read them on the air. Thanks again, Brett. For years now, we have been anxiously awaiting the arrival of Star Wars: Galaxy's Edge. It is pegged to be a truly revolutionary land and will bring in attractions, atmosphere, and technologies that will launch a new era in theme parks. While we are only months away from the opening of the land in Disneyland, and a little bit further away from the opening in Hollywood Studios at Walt Disney World, we are still unaware of most of the things that will be in the land. So that's what we wanted to do here today. Discuss everything that we know so far, including some details WDW Opinion has stumbled upon that haven't made their rounds to the general public yet. Just like the films that inspired this land, we anticipate having multiple episodes of the podcast that discuss further details in the months to come. That's why we're calling this segment Star Wars: Galaxy's Edge, Episode 1, What We Know So Far. So let's go to Black Spire Outpost today on WDW Opinion. So Hank, I think, you know, it's safe to say, I feel like I get caught up in this a lot, where I'm hyping up Galaxy's Edge so much. I'm like, oh, it's going to be revolutionary. It's going to be incredible. And then people are like, oh yeah, what's going to be there? And I'm like, oh, well, there's going to be like a ride on like a Millennium Falcon. And they're like, oh wow, where are you going to go? And I'm like, I don't know.
There'll be consequences though.
There'll be consequences to your actions. And they're like, well, what the heck does that mean? I'm like, I don't know. I think there's so much. I mean, it's the hype train, obviously, because it's a big entity. It's a big intellectual property, but there's also that sense of unknown. And I think, you know, the Wizarding World of Harry Potter, Diagon Alley, down the street at Universal Orlando has really, you know, kept people's expectations very high at what Disney can do to directly counter with this kind of land, you know?
Yeah. I'll tell you what, though, Connor, which is why I'm excited for this segment today. It feels like the stuff that's come up just, you know, in front of us in the past week, give it.
Yeah.
It has started to get to a level where, like, I'm like, wow, this may actually exceed my expectations. There's stuff that's coming out that it's hard to believe that they could exceed the bar that Harry Potter World set by, like, clearing it.
But it's even hard to believe that, because in my mind, I'm thinking I'm going to go there and not fully understand how they're doing all this. Not fully comprehend, like, wait, are we this advanced as, like, a society right now, like, technology-wise, that we can do these things? And by these things, I mean, they're saying when you go in the Millennium Falcon ride and you pilot the ride, which you're going to be able to do, if you mess up, because unlike Mission Space, where if you don't – spoiler alert – if you don't move the joystick in Mission Space, it's the same story. You know, here, if you don't move the joystick, apparently you could crash, right? And certain instances would happen. Well, if that happens to you, they're saying when you go out to meet, you know, the bartenders or the shopkeepers, those people are going to interact with you and say, I heard you crash the Millennium Falcon, even though no one brought it up around you. Not fully realizing that there's a way for that to exist in a land that's man-made, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's the big thing for me. I'm not going to believe it even when I'm there.
Yeah. It's really neat to see it all start to piece together. I mean, stuff that we've been looking at, just a handful of renderings for years.
Years. Yeah,
now,
yeah.
Ever since they announced this. And it's all starting to, you know, like, stuff, they're putting the final touches of paint on stuff out west in Anaheim. You know, the high rises are all getting, you know, the rock formations are really clearing in together.
The petrified trees.
Yeah, the petrified trees. I mean, it's a realization of something that they've been planning for so long. And Connor, you and I just decided this week, it was like, you know, there's so many times on this podcast where I feel like we're like, oh, don't talk about Star Wars because it's too big. We'll have to, you know, save that for the future. It's time to start capping stuff open because it's too big to ignore.
Yes.
It is the elephant in the room that everyone wants to hear about. So here it is. Unless you don't want to hear about it, let us know. And then also, I think it's fitting that we have a colon in the title of this week's episode, because Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, Black Spire Outpost, is the land of colons.
They got a surplus of colons in this puppy.
Millennium Falcon, Smuggler's Run, Rise of the Resistance, something, something. It's another thing, right?
Isn't every single ride going to be named Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, Millennium Falcon, Smuggler's Run?
Yeah, I think so.
Nine colons in one.
That's some SEO. They're really driving up their search engine optimization for the parks.
Yeah, it's crazy, man. All these names. I mean, we've talked about that before too. We've talked about how the full name of the land is Star Wars Galaxy's Edge Black Spire Outpost, and then it's on the planet of Naboo.
Batuu.
Sorry.
Yeah, it's. But yeah, let's get into it. Let's this past couple weeks, like we said, there's been a lot of stuff coming out.
So what we know so far that will be in it,
yes,
are the two attractions, right? So leading up to, I would say, before Christmas, I was thinking very much that it was going to be very like Pandora, in the two attractions we were going to get is one big e-ticket attraction. And Pandora, it's Avatar Flight of Passage, and one lesser, kind of more tame attraction that anyone can go on, but when you get off it, you're going to be like, that was all right, in Navi River Journey, which, by the way, I've come to really grow and appreciate, but it's still no, you know, Flight of Passage. And then they dropped a trailer for the land that gave us the most footage we've seen yet. They dropped this trailer during the Disney Parks Christmas Parade on ABC on Christmas Day. And we got to actually see some, I think, on-ride footage of the second attraction, Rise of the Resistance.
Which also reminds me, sorry to interrupt, Did you notice how Disney tweeted out the full video, like at the beginning of the show?
It was
before it had aired on TV.
It was totally, yeah. They did that on accident, no doubt about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I thought
because
so.
I watched it, and then I turned on the Christmas parade, and they're like, and coming up, we're going to show you Star Wars Galaxy's Edge. And I was like, they totally sent that at the wrong
fools.
Time.
And, yeah, and it was up for like 40 minutes or something.
And sure
too.
Enough, I went right before it came on, and it was deleted.
Yeah,
and then
wow.
they re-uploaded it. So anyway, wow. so when we heard of things, the big e-ticket attraction was Millennium Falcon : Smuggler's Run. We knew we were going to be able to pilot the Millennium Falcon, and we thought that that was going to be the big, big, big e-ticket attraction. And we thought Rise of the Resistance, which we've come to learn the name in recent months, was going to be a, like a B attraction, you know? Well, I think these two are going to be equal e-ticket attractions. So don't you think, Hank?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I think Rise of the Resistance is going to be a kind of not a dark ride, but it's going to seems like it's going to be a trackless ride system, which means you're not really sure where the car is going to go. Like there's no actual track underneath you, obviously, but you're going to be, you know, interacting with resistance members, or you're going to be part of the resistance and you're going to be boarding, you know, an Empire spaceship.
Yeah. And the thing that I think tripped that switch for you and I, we talked about this a little bit on Christmas Day, was this, I can't remember what Imagineer it was, but he was like, this is one of the best rides we've ever built in the parks.
Yeah.
And I'm like, whoa, you're supposed to be saying about that, about the other ride.
About, yeah, Millennium Falcon, and he's here saying it about Rise of the Resistance. And the way it came off, this guy describing it was like, he was pumped, you know, he was excited. And that's what Imagineers typically get. You can read Imagineer pretty well on their excitement level of an attraction. They come out, they're like, oh, it's a great, you know, journey through this and stuff. But if they're like, this is intense, this is a big deal, then it really is a big deal. And when they're saying that about Rise of the Resistance, you got to elevate that up to Millennium Falcon level for sure.
Yeah. So that was a big thing. Connor, you also said, let's see, if we're running through the stuff that we know about the land, Olga's Canteen. Now, are there two restaurants, or is the canteen, is that?
I'm not sure. I haven't really seen a whole lot of confirmation.
They've been
of
playing that down a little bit.
Food-wise, yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, expect this to be kind of looking like where you encounter Han in Star Wars.
For the first time.
Kind of some seedy individuals would probably be there. Probably be able to get, you know, your blue milk. I think I mentioned this on a previous episode that we were unable to release that had to re-record, but I don't think I mentioned it in the re-recording. There's a brewery out of Miami that has been contracted to brew the Galaxy's Edge beer. And a blogger went down there and drank it because they're already selling it at their brewery, and it's legitimately named Galaxy Edge's beer. And it's like, wow. They say it's tart and it's sweet. And the guy was like, I really don't like sour beers and stuff, but this was fantastic. So
awesome.
They're going to have
another unique touch,
some unique beers coming to this land and some unique drinks as well.
And then, so kind of where can I visit this land inside the parks? Cause that's the last piece of information that we would have known.
So this
before,
land
you know.
Basically took up the backlot area, where you used to go on the backlot tour, where Avenue of America was, which was like where the Osborne Festival of Lights was.
Mm-hmm.
That whole area became this, and so it's gigantic. I mean, I think it's like 14 acres, something like that. But the way you're going to get through it is the newly designed area called Grand Avenue, which is in between Muppet Courtyard and the Sci-Fi Drive-In. That is where you're going to have to enter. And right now, if you go over there, you can pass by Baseline Tap House, which is one of my favorite places to stop and grab a drink and just relax in Hollywood Studios. It's a new brew pub kind of thing with snacks and beers. It's great. You walk past that, there's this big archway. That's going to be the main entrance into this land. Reason being is it's very
kind of like a tunnel almost. The way it looks like you come in. It looks like you maybe like come up a little. Ooh, speaking of the big reveal, maybe that's what it's going to be
exactly
like.
Exactly what they're doing.
Yeah,
you know, they're you're traveling light years into the distance. So you can get to this area. It's not going to be right smack in front of you. You're going to have to enter, and then there's the reveal, kind of like in Magic Kingdom when you see the castle. That's what
it's going to be special. It's going to be good.
The reason they're putting it there, you know, the sidewalks are large, but there's not a whole lot of things in that area, so people can back up very far in order to get in, because we anticipate some pretty big lines to get into the lane.
Yeah, that's speaking of stuff that we don't know yet, we really don't know how they're going to manage crowds truly going in and out of that area of the park. We keep on hearing about lines and prepping these areas around it, but
we're also hearing things on a couple other podcasts about how Disney might be toying with the idea of selling passes to get into the land. So almost like a fast pass just to get into the land. That'll come with, you know, fast passes. You'll basically buy those things. You'll buy an enhanced ticket to guarantee entrance to the land, and it'll be so expensive that you'll also get like a free ride on both attractions.
Yeah.
So
now put away your pitchforks. It sounds like they won't do that out of the gate.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like they'll just, so it's not like Disney's going to gouge you to death from the day that it opens.
Exactly.
We hear you. We heard how hard it is to get in the park, and we're giving you a solution.
Here's the option.
Not like, hey, let's milk this thing for even more money after, you know, raising ticket prices and slamming the park full every single day, you know, that type of thing.
Exactly. And they think it's going to be so big that there's only going to be one entrance and one exit. The one entrance will be Grand Avenue, like I was saying, over by Muppets Courtyard. And the exit will actually be through Toy Story Land. So you'll basically make a big loop and or big U-shape, I guess. And you'll then exit into a new land in Toy Story Land. So it's interesting.
Oh man, Connor, I'm so excited to talk about all the stuff that we've learned though in these past couple days.
Do you want to kick it off? You really sure led the charge on this.
Well, yeah, it all kind of, you know, it started with a murmur and grew into a roar. But it's that Barron's article that came out earlier this week. Actually, when was the date on that? I should just double check that. The date on the Barron's article was January 3rd, so a little while back. But you know, as a digital article would. It has longer legs online. So it was an exclusive interview with Bob Iger, CEO of Disney, the Walt Disney Company. The Barron's is a nice financial publication. They've got quite the clout in the financial industry, and you know, it's, you know, a widely read digital publication online. So this was no slouch of an interview. This is a big deal. And I think the reason that it finally made its way to the Disney Twitterverse was Bob Iger said the date that it's going to open in Anaheim.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, oh my God, we thought that, you know, we didn't know when this was going to come out, yada, yada, yada. So he kind of, whether it was let it slip or it was just time for it to release, he said June.
Yeah.
So, and now a lot of people have pinpointed based on, I don't even know what kind of math they do. It looks like this weekend of like June 21st and 22nd, around there is when everyone is expecting Galaxy's Edge to open up now in Anaheim. But then in that article, there's a whole lot of other stuff that people didn't really added more color to these rides or the attractions that are in the area. Definitely about the blue milk that you can. What did he add about the blue milk? I can't remember. I don't have a Barron's subscription.
I think he said something about how.
I did print it off though.
It was talking about intellectual properties. So it was like, yeah, we have these incredible things, so you bet we're going to be able to give you the opportunity to drink blue milk, you know, something like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it was interesting. I mean, I think he revealed some things that, you know, we hardcore Disney Parks fans have known for a while, but that people have.
Yeah, you know, that's a good point, Connor. And that's something that we should reemphasize is that when he goes out and does an interview like this, and it makes it into one of these publications and then makes the rounds throughout the internet, it's touching a whole different realm of fans and observers that don't experience, you know, Disney World Twitter.
Yeah.
That type of thing. So when I emailed you this, Connor, like a news a newsletter that I subscribe to, Recode, which you know is like kind of a tech newsletter, leads off with Bob Iger's comments about the park and talking about this amazing land that Disney is building. You know, our listeners of the podcast will be like, yeah, I know that's coming. But like now the whole world is starting to wake up and go, whoa,
did you
something
see,
big's happening down there.
Did you see that Recode got it wrong though?
Yeah, in the subject line too.
What did it say? What was the subject line?
It was like simultaneously opening.
Yeah, they said...
And they never apologized for that.
Yeah, Disneyland and Hollywood Studios will have simultaneously opened lands. No, we know that it's coming in the summer. They've already announced this, that coming in the summer to Disneyland, coming in the fall to Disney World. Yeah.
And I read that subject line and I was like, I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. Like maybe they met in the same year. And then you read the second sentence and it's like, they're both opening in June.
Yeah, you're like, no. But my dad sent me an article from Yahoo that was, you know, talking about the consequence aspect of it, which Iger commented on. So Yahoo was just ripping it from Barron's. And my dad was like, this is crazy, this section of it. And I'm like, you don't even know the half of it, because a lot of us don't know the half of it. I sure don't. I mean, how they're going to be able to pull these things off.
Connor, you're a former cast member. Imagine this nightmare, working in Disney World between June and whatever, November, December, and having to deal with the guests that go, oh, wait, where's the entrance to Galaxy's Edge? I thought that opened up in June.
Yeah. We're just going to go on the Millennium Falcon. You put me in that direction. Yep, you just go right there and take the right. The one that says Muppet Vision 3D? Yep, that's it.
No, I thought you were going to direct him to the airport. Get on a plane, buy a ticket to Anaheim.
We could do that. We could. You
can take a left out of here.
Yeah, that'll be funny. I ever
tell that will happen.
I ever tell you a story about the lady that came up to me at the Yacht and Beach Club and said she was there for a conference. Said, "Okay, I need to get my child a gift.
Oh boy,
because I'm here and I need to get him a souvenir." I'm like, "Okay." She's like, "So where do I find the Harry Potter stuff?" And I'm like, "Harry Potter's not a Disney; it's Universal." She's like, "I thought that was the same thing." I'm like, "No, it's like our main competitor." She's like, "Okay." Yeah. She's like, "Well, I need some Minion stuff then." And I'm like, Minions is also Universal. She's like, "Wait, if Harry Potter is Universal and Minions are Universal, then what is Disney?" And I wanted to be like, "Do you think those are the only two things that exist in the world, Harry Potter and Minions, ma'am?" No.
That's a blood-boiling comment.
Or another one is always...
You got to remain cool and calm in those situations, Connor. Yeah.
Another one is always, "Where's Disney World?" And I'm like, "You're in Disney World." And they're like, no. Like, where is it from here? And they're referring to the Magic Kingdom. Like, Point I'm trying to make is there's a whole nother world out there that isn't filled with crazy Disney people like us. Yeah. And that's fine.
That read blueprints for rides that are opening up.
Yeah. They're not talking about a land and a theme park on multiple episodes of a podcast.
So one of these news outlets that's kind of in the Disneyverse is Theme Park Insider. And they did some deep diving and digging and started to stitch a whole bunch of stuff together to help us paint a better, clearer picture these past couple weeks of, what's happening there? How's stuff coming along? When's it going to be done? What can fans expect type of thing? So they also informed me, I don't know how they found this, but there is a Twitter account out there. It is at @SW_Edge, which is Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, which is a Disney enthusiast, a friend of a cast member, someone that posts a lot of pictures. Actually had a nice chat with him on Twitter the other day, just who is very enthusiastic about Star Wars Galaxy's Edge and has a lot of cool stuff. He shares flyovers and stuff that you've seen from other rides or attractions around the parks. But starting to share some pretty cool blueprints for the rides that really have started to open up my eyes, and I think your eyes too, Connor, about like what we're going to experience on these rides.
Do you want to elaborate on what he's told you?
What should I go with first? Millennium Falcon or Rise of the Resistance?
Let's go Millennium Falcon.
Millennium Falcon. So
colon Smuggler's Run.
We knew a little bit about the way that this the mechanism for the attraction would work, which is it's like a giant wheel and a bunch of virtual ride simulators that just are attached to it and can move all over the place. Yeah. I mean, it's a virtual simulator, so it doesn't really matter what the ride mechanism looks like. But should you need to know, it's a giant wheel that kind of, you know, they're all, let's think of a clock, and there's like eight machines that all face inward towards the center of the clock, and it spins around. You get on at this, not the same point, that's part of this explanation. So let's say you get on at 5 o'clock is where the car the back doors open up, you get in, all six of the people get in, and then your screen starts on the front and you're controlling the Millennium Falcon. Meanwhile, it rotates clockwise around the outside of the circle, and then, and this is part of the interesting stuff that we've come to learn in the past couple weeks, doesn't stop at what I say. I said you got on at 5 o'clock.
Yeah.
Doesn't stop at 5 o'clock again. It's going to stop at 4 o'clock. And you're going to get off on a place that looks like the entrance that you just got on. So you never break from that total immersion of walking on and off the Millennium Falcon. So how cool is that?
So it's going to be like, it's going to park, it's going to seem like it's parked where it took off.
Yes, exactly.
That's crazy.
Exactly. It's crazy. And if you think about it, so this is a nice transition into, like, you know, the way that Disney's really committing. They're really, really going after the full immersion. Nothing's just going to happen in this land. You're not all of a sudden going to be on a spaceship. You're not just going to be somewhere else. Everything needs to make sense. You can't just, like, expect to all of a sudden be on, you know, a launch pad getting ready to go into Mission Space's, you know, mission. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They have to. There has to be a story for every single element. So the element that they're using in the Millennium Falcon Smuggler's Run is this trickery where they snake the queue through the building and make you think towards the end of the queue that you're actually walking kind of back outside and getting on the full-size Millennium Falcon that's parked out front, which is crazy. That's awesome.
It's crazy to think that that it's going to exist that way, you know? I mean, just logistically.
And then it's just
going
to take right off.
That's always my big thing. It's the logistics behind everything. Like, the picking of the queues, the picking of the entrance, like, how it winds its way around. I'm just always fascinated by, you know, you can come up with a story and stuff like that, but how is it going to work? It's like in-world such UX design, you know?
Such a deep layer of storytelling.
And they're saying something like, you're going to be in the Millennium Falcon and you're going to be looking out the windows and it's going to look like you're flying, obviously. And Hank, do you remember the stat on the computer processing, like, graphics cards for each of these things?
Oh, gosh, it's insane. I can't remember, though.
It's like the most advanced computer graphics card. It's like from Intel. It's not from Intel. It's from something else. But it's like each one of these bad boys costs like an arm and a leg. Like,
oh yeah,
millions 200 of arms and legs. That's how much it costs.
And we got dozens of these ships flying around that people are going to be driving. Well,
just so that it looks as clear and as lifelike as possible. And
yeah, and then so it'll land back where it took off. And so when you get off the ride and you walk outside, you can point at that ship and you go, I just flew that out of here.
I flew that.
And came back
in.
And I crashed it. And I crashed it. But it looks pretty good.
That's going to be a thing, you know. The people in the ride will have to actually do their roles. They'll have to be the pilot. They'll have to be the co-pilot.
Yeah.
And if they trip up along the way, the Falcon could crash, things like that.
Yep.
We heard in a couple other podcasts that that their sources are saying if no one touches anything, there's also a story that will happen for that. It's going to cue off of very much of Star Tours, you know, the adventure continues, the new iteration of Star Tours that launched, God, probably like 5-6 years ago, where there's so many multiple stories that you could encounter. It's going to be the same way for the Millennium Falcon. It's going to be like no two rides are going to be the same.
Incredible. So we're really excited for that one. Also, I guess we should, before we move on to Rise of the Resistance, this same Twitter account actually sent us a blueprint of what the line looks like a little bit just at the very end of the queue, right before you're about to get on. the Millennium Falcon. And the queue, obviously, you know, kind of enters and goes around that circle center hub of the Millennium Falcon and cuts through the famous area of, you know, the couch with the table. And there's some photos of cast members working on that area on this SW_Edge Twitter account, which inevitably, I think, just based on some of the writing and scribbles on this little part of it, is it's part of the queue. So you'll have plenty of an opportunity to take a photo in there, really experience that part of the ship. But I think it's going to be a pre-show area. I think from everything I can see, there's going to be some type of screen that's preparing you for the next room. Like, you can actually sit on the couch while the screen's going on. People will be hanging about in there. Yeah. They'll definitely use that room to storytell.
Yeah, for sure.
Not that they need to. It'll speak for itself. But they'll use. I think there's going to be some type of screen in there, too.
Yeah, and those things usually work just as a way to hold people for a little bit, entertain them, and then, you know, move them on. They're going to teach them, you know, how you're going to operate the thing. I assume it's going to be a complex ride system in that it's not going to be a roller coaster. You're not going to get on and not have to do anything. They're going to have to educate people all throughout the queue so that once they sit down, they know what they're doing. And also, once they get on, they know to sit down because there's going to be a gigantic wait for this. So the more they can educate people, and the more people know what they're doing as soon as they step on, the quicker the process is going to go unload and load-wise for everyone.
It's also interesting to note, since while we're talking about it, since we've got our free pass to talk as much as we want about the stuff we know, sounds like Disney is going to go great lengths to, based on other stuff that we're hearing, to make sure that these cast members really, really politely crack the whip on people getting on and off the Millennium Falcon, because it is going to be one of the coolest things you've ever done, especially if you're a Star Wars fan. And you're going to want to take pictures. You're going to want the cast member to take pictures. You're going to want to take selfies. You're going to want to look at everything. And they're like, listen, pal, we got 45 seconds before we got to load the next ship.
Yeah.
Not like that. But they're really going to be cracking the whip.
Yeah. So hopefully the cast members can stick to it, because I know it's easy to cave, you know, when someone politely asks you to do something and you have to deny them. But
nothing I can do. Sorry.
Nothing I can do.
It could be like, you know, the Imperial or the Resistance is saying you got to get off.
Yeah.
They can act better than I can. All right. Rise of the Resistance. This is now the big one, it seems like.
Yeah.
So from this account, you know, I guess as a disclaimer too, but we're so far along in the process that these, you know, blueprints are pretty much sealed.
Oh yeah,
the deal is sealed. So, Connor, we heard elements of this in the past, that Rise of the Resistance was this dark ride.
Yeah,
it was kind of a dark, trackless ride with big show scenes, and you know, they were really talking it up, the Imagineers and Disney property, and it was like, and they kept saying it was like nothing you've ever done before. And we're like, all right, you know, I don't know what that means.
There's plenty of rides I've never done before.
Right. There's plenty of dark, trackless rides with big show scenes. Mm-hmm. And you're just kind of like, okay, well, it's going to be cool. And then stuff started to leak, like, you're going to have to hustle off because they're going to catch you. Or, like, there's going to be these elements of, like, moving between, like, one ship to another. I'm like, well, that doesn't really make sense.
Yeah.
Like, how are you I can't wait to see. And so now we're finally getting, so spoiler, you can genuinely, you know, stop listening if you don't want to hear this. But
it's incredible. It's absolutely incredible.
Yeah, it is absolutely incredible. Yeah, you don't want to. So anyways, it sounds like this trackless part of the ride is just one ride portion of the entire attraction, which is made up of three rides all put together. Whoa. So you start to piece together, like, how, why? Like, why do they need to do this? And it's pretty simple. It's what we talked about with this Disney storytelling element. You're on Batuu. You're at the Black Spire Outpost. Disney said from the beginning that this is a ride on the inside of a Star Destroyer.
Yeah.
How do you get there? You got to ride some type of vehicle up to the ship. So part one of this ride is going to be, as it was described to me by the owner of this Twitter account, it's kind of like a mechanism that's built similarly to like a Dumbo attraction.
Yeah.
but with like virtual reality elements and some way more unrestricted movement of the vehicles that will simulate you going up to the ship. And so if you picture this Dumbo ride, imagine you get on it on the second floor, like you board when the Dumbo is up in the air.
Yeah, is that its peak?
And while you're being simulated, you know, space flight, this thing is actually rotating you, taking you down a floor where you're going to hustle off onto the Star Destroyer.
Yeah.
How cool is that?
Yeah. So it's basically transporting you to the Star Destroyer. You get off and you got to hustle to, you know, your next transport vehicle.
Right. And so a lot of people have questions. My brother was asking, you know, like, so what does that mean? You got to wait for another ride? Well, no. It'll probably be a very similar to, like, in a way, the way that you feel like kind of when you go through Tower of Terror, like after you, and you're in that pre-show room and then everyone joins together back again in the back.
Yeah.
And there's like a little bit of a queue, but not too much. I think there'll probably be even less in Rise of the Resistance before you board the next ride vehicle, which is this 8-person seated car. Also a photo that's been leaking out the past couple weeks. Piloted by a droid that's going to take you through the ship. Sounds like you get caught. Some other big encounters with some full-size AT-ATs roaming through the ship.
AT-AT is crazy, man.
Yeah.
And we've
50 animatronic stormtroopers that are supposed to be on this attraction as well.
I mean, that is so many. When you think of the scale of animatronics, like you think one of the more populated animatronic rides in like Splash Mountain. Or then you also think of like pirates. Like think of pirates, but
Hall of Presidents, 43 of them.
but more high level animatronics, like brand new animatronics that are probably doing more like choreographed, complicated maneuvers.
It does make you shiver a little bit. Like imagine on this ride. I mean, there's so many things you can imagine, and it's still going to blow us away.
Because
can you imagine like on this?
That's the big point. The big point is, even though we're saying this, like what's going to happen, you can only describe this. The phrase that words can't do it justice, like you're still going to have to experience it. We could sit here and explain to you the inner workings of the entire thing and how incredible it is, but you have to be able to experience this to truly appreciate that. I firmly believe that that's what's going to happen here.
Yeah, can you imagine? Like, I mean, there's so many things they can do. The Imagineers will blow our mind, but, you know, about to round a corner, this machine, since it's trackless, peeks around the corner. Here come 8 animatronic stormtroopers marching your way. Oop, back up.
Back up.
Hide behind the corner.
Back.
There's so many things that can happen we've never experienced before on a ride.
The potential is limitless.
Yeah. And then there's going to be a third element of the attraction that's going to be some type of ride vehicle that will take you inevitably off the planet back down to Earth.
Yeah.
Or not Earth. Sorry. Batuu.
Batuu.
Oh, okay. There it is. That's a lot of stuff.
And there's still so much that we don't know. You know, like
there's still
how the
plenty
procedure is going to work. What are the stores going to look like? How are you going to interact with cast members there? How are you going to interact with villagers? How are you going to interact with, you know, this area is a trading post that has some pretty seedy individuals. Like, how is that going to play out? Are there going to be entertainers in there? I mean, there's so much, but what we've told you and what we've spent the last 30 minutes talking about, I think it's just the tip of the iceberg, and it's some really incredible stuff that, you know, Hank's been able to dive deep and find out more about, you know, on Twitter and stuff, and what we know through articles, through other podcasts and stuff like that. But I think the hype is going to be worth it. I do believe that. I think
it's approaching there, isn't it?
It sounds like the Imagineers, you know, came to play, and more importantly, it's sounding like, you know, Disney corporate let them do it. You know, they didn't, you know, curtail them at all. They didn't take away any of their money or any of their tools, which we've seen many, many times before.
Connor, great point.
Yeah,
great point. It seemed like the gloves are off.
The gloves are off.
They were like, you know what, guys? This is going to be a hit. Go. Just do what you guys do.
You gotta trust them. You gotta trust them.
Wow. Yeah, that's a good way of thinking about it. The gloves have been on for number of years, but they really went crazy.
Are off. So, I mean, we're going to do some more episodes like this. We're thinking about doing maybe a one closer to opening. We're going to do a opening day reactions, first impressions, our first impressions when we go there. I think we have a couple more potential episodes on this topic. But for this week, that is going to do it for us. As always, thank you so very much for listening to the show. Be sure to rate and review us on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever you listen to podcasts, and share the show with someone you think might enjoy it. If you like what you heard today, then you've been listening to the WDW Opinion Podcast. If by chance you didn't like what you heard, then you've been listening to Fill in the Blanks. For Hank, I'm Connor. We'll see you real soon.